Hey, I'm Alex Radcliffe from Board Game Co. And today I'm doing a video of the top 10 games I play with my wife and kids. Now this one is a patron-selected video. Once a month, my patrons get to come up with their own topic, not vote on one of mine, but rather they literally come up with their own topic, and the one that gets the most votes is, well, the video I do. Now this isn't a video I would have specifically chosen because it's more personal, which I don't mind personal, don't get me wrong. If you watch this channel, you know that, but this isn't a top 10 kids game. This isn't a top 10 couples game. This isn't even a top 10 family games. This is actually very specific of the top 10 games I play with my wife and kids, which means perhaps I was unnecessarily pedantic in the choosing of these games, but I chose games that I literally have played with my wife and kids and not games I would play with my wife and kids. So for instance, just to give you one example of that, Indigo is a game that did not make the cut because I have actually never played this with my wife and kids. I have played this one with my kids. I totally would play it with my wife and kids. It just never happened. And part of that is, thank God, we have, you know, four healthy kids, and one of them's a child, and one of them's a baby, less than a year old, no, over a year old by now. But that does make finding the time to play together sometimes hard. I frequently play with my daughters and sons, and daughter and sons, and I frequently play games with my wife, but the overlap sometimes is sometimes harder, because I'll play games with my wife in the evening, and then I'll play games with my kids during the day, but then either myself or my wife are watching the baby, so often we're taking turns in terms of what we're doing, and so sometimes we just don't play games together as a family as much as I would like, although it has happened before, it will happen again. This list does comprise of all of that. But in any case, I guess my starting point is Indigo is an excellent game that I totally would play with my wife and kids, but I happen to have not done so that one's not on this list over here. And I'm going to start this off with Codenames Duet. Codenames Duet is not only probably my favorite game to play with my wife in terms of I was recommending a single couples game that I think is amazing for everyone and everyone should give a try, it would be Codenames Duet. But I also like playing this one, and Codenames is an acceptable substitute here as well. I also really enjoy playing this one with my wife and my daughter, and it's technically a two-player game, but taking turns is fun. This is one that my 9-year-old daughter will play with me. She is particularly loves the clue nature of the game of trying to craft a perfect clue. Because in Codenames, you have these cards, this 5x5 grid of cards, and you're trying to give a clue, and that clue might be, I don't know, orange 3, and then you realize, wait a second, there's a tiger there, so that could be orange, there's an apple there, maybe you meant the correlation to apple. You have to look through those grid of cards and come up with the various clues that you think fits the code word. It is a game where you have to see the pattern hidden in the weeds and understand both what you want to get as well as what you have to avoid and then give a clue or guess accordingly. I love Codenames. I incredibly recommend Codenames. This again, like I said, if I had to recommend a single couples game that I would recommend for everyone across the board, it would be Codenames Duet. And this game, like I said, is enjoyable with my wife and daughter as well. My daughter loves that aspect of trying to figure out those clues. My sons, who are seven and six respectively, they do not particularly, they're not there yet in terms of wanting that kind of word puzzle. They're still in that learning to read process. They haven't figured out the enjoyableness, the fun of clever wordplay and seeing associations and whatnot. So this is not one that they play yet. But for my wife and daughter, it is a thoroughly enjoyable game that I almost didn't include this one when I was picking which games would or wouldn't make the cut, because I do think of it more as a two-player game, but I think it's an excellent, excellent experience. And I've played at teams as well, you know, my wife, my daughter, myself, and one other person. But I think it's an excellent deduction game. It is a game that really makes you think. If you're looking for something that is not just pure fluff, something that will really drive home those neurons firing, finding those pathways and whatnot, I think Codenames is a great game, which should be self-evident from the way I'm talking about it. From there we have Cobra Pop. Cobra Pop, which apparently the insert's not in there, resulting in the tumbling of all these tiles. Cobra Paw is a game in which you will be... Those are the tile situation. Cobra Paw is a little speed-based game, speed-based matching. What you're going to do is you're going to have these tiles on the board, and you're going to put the tiles in the center, and then you're going to roll a die, and you're going to roll two dice, and the combination of what shows up on those two dice tells you which of the tiles you have to grab, because each tile has one of six different symbols in them, but then when you combine the different symbols and the interplay, there are a whole bunch of resulting tiles, maybe 15, something like that, tiles unique with each of the two symbols, and so you roll the die and you come up with the blue flower and the orange little grid or whatnot, and then you have to find that pattern and instantly grab it. If you grab wrong, if you grab incorrectly, there's a penalty associated. So you want to be sure, you want to be fast, but you also want to be right. This is likely my children's favorite game, my boy specifically, in terms of games that my 5-year-old and my 6-year-old and my 7-year-old, I should get those ages down, in terms of games that my 6-year-old and my 7-year-old love to play both together as a family, as well as just the two of them on the floor going back and forth enjoying that. In fact, this is technically a game that my 1-year-old also likes to play with, but he's not really playing it correctly. He's just grabbing and trying to eat these tiles, which may explain why we're missing tiles. Are giant tiles, bakelite pieces, unhealthy for children? I don't entirely know, but we are missing a few tiles, so who really knows? But in any case, Cobra Bot is an excellent game that I think really does. It's one of those games that, while obviously not a gamer's game in the typical sense, it's speed-based and matching and whatnot, I think it's the kind of experience that embodies the fun of board games. It's the kind of thing, when you start off with games with your family, with your children and all that, you're going to want to find things that make them like games. They're not going to walk into Caverna and think this is a fun experience, obviously. You want something that makes them realize and understand that there's a reason board games can be so prevalent in people's lives. There's a reason why that social aspect, why the fun, the laughter, all that, well, inspires a love of board games. From there, we have Project L. And Project L, sadly, is one where turning the box will not help. There's not a lot going on here in terms of the visibility of, well, the back of the box is that, so nothing going to help you there. Project L, I just did a review on, or recently did a review on. You can check that out. But Project L is a surprisingly accessible engine builder. This is one in which you are slowly building up your engine while disguised as a Polyomino game, and I think that makes it an excellent choice, especially if you have already introduced your family to Polyomino games. Polyomino games have that fun aspect of trying to fit together different shapes and patterns and seeing what they are. My children have basically played nearly all of my Polyomino games. I say nearly all, perhaps. Well, they haven't played Feast for Odin. That seems a little bit out of their reach. They have played most, if not all, of the Polyomino games in my collection, and they generally enjoy most of those. And from there, going to Project L is an excellent and somewhat obvious next step in introducing a new mechanic disguised as a Polyomino game, because in Project L, you technically have these little boxes that you're filling with Polyomino shapes to score points and earn more tiles, but in reality, what's actually happening in this game is this is an engine builder. It's a game where, as you slowly improve your pieces, as you slowly acquire more puzzles, you can take more and more efficient actions. The most efficient action in this game, assuming you're not playing with the expansion, would be putting down, in one single move, putting down 4 pieces into your tiles, but 4 of the larger pieces, but it takes a long time to get to that point, and so you have to figure out what pathway towards that engine building you're going to take. Are you going to try to upgrade pieces, complete more puzzles, earn more pieces? Are you going to try to, which way are you going to try to push for that end game? Through either completing as much as possible as fast as possible, or completing a little bit of things while you upgrade your engine so that if the game lasts long enough, you will be able to clear out 1 or 2 puzzles every single turn. It is an engine builder disguised as a Polyomino game, which introduces new mechanics. Plus, speaking of eating Bakelite, if you want to eat Bakelite, I mean, I don't know if it's Bakelite, but these chiclet pieces are amazing to eat. Speaking of Polyomino games, we have Baron Park. Baron Park, which, and I'm going to flip the box, don't lose your mind that the box top is on the wrong side. Baron Park is one of my favorite, if not my favorite, Polyomino game. I think the current competition for fighting for this spot is, well, technically Project L is also fighting, but I really don't consider Project L that much of a Polyomino game. And in terms of Baron Park, what's it called? Planet Unknown, which I am eagerly waiting for, is a game that I have played and I think might pull in for that tough spot in Polyomino games. But until then, Baron Park is one of my favorite, if not my favorite, Polyomino game. It is a game that I will simultaneously happily play with adults, while also happily playing with my kids, while also happily playing with my wife and my kids. This is one that we have frequently pulled out, and it works for all age levels. Myself and my wife were obviously playing a game trying to get as many points as possible, because in Baron Park, you're trying to fill your bear park with all these Polyomino pieces, and as you try to do that, every time you fill in one of your tiles, you're going to earn a bear statue, which slowly decreasingly go down in points, so you're going to be worth fewer and fewer points as the game progresses. Additionally, you're going for these variable scoring mechanisms that will be different every game. There's 3 different ways to score additional points if you potentially link your rivers together, or have 3 greenery tiles together, or if you're the first one to get the 3 excavator tiles, which are these larger, more complicated, but more points pieces to get into your board. There are a lot of different ways to play the game. The expansion will add even more variability. I love the monorails. I love those giant beer tiles. There's a lot of variability added in the expansion, but the base game is fun in and of itself. And like I said, this is one that I will happily play it at game night with my friends, trying to out-eke the slightly better park. And I'll also happily play it with my 5-year-old, who, granted, generally doesn't win. 6-year-olds, jeez it. I just can't, you know, my 6-year-old. I happily play it with my 6-year-old, who will try to fit as many tiles into his park as possible, not winning the game, but certainly having fun building out the perfect bear park. Next up from there, we have Leo the Lion. Leo the Lion is, oh my gosh, I love this game. This is one of those games that I consider to be a sleeper hit. Baron Park, Codenames, Project L, and even Cobra Pot to a degree are somewhat well-known games. Whereas Leo the Lion is a memory game that I rarely see anyone talk about. I rarely see this mentioned at all, and I've said it's a memory game, and I still like it a lot. And the reason for that is it's a cooperative memory game. This is not a memory game where you have to try to figure out who has the best memory. I consider those games to be, well, frankly, not fun. I mean, when I play a board game, I'm not trying to have a competition who can remember better. That's not what I'm personally looking for. But when it's not a competition, when it's teamwork, that I can get behind. In Leo the Lion, Leo was trying to get his hair cut, and he walks along this pathway trying to get to the barber before the day is up. The problem is every time you reveal a tile, he stops to talk to one of his friends, and the amount of time you lose is variable. So perhaps you only have 12 hours in a day, and perhaps you get stuck and you spend 3 hours talking to a snake. That happens to you. I mean, it happens to me every single morning. And so as he continues going, you're going to run out of time, and you'll have to start again and reset. And then you'll flip those tiles face down, and you all have to remember together which tiles were where. Because one of the things you can do is, as you play these different cards to move, if your color matches the specific animal that you're trying to talk to, then you don't actually waste that time. Then you are efficient at moving past that animal. And so you have to figure it out. Because on day two, you suddenly are right there and you're like, I'm pretty sure that snake over there with a three was over there. If you play a blue card, we should be good and we can skip it. And somebody does have the blue two. And so you play the two and you land in the snake and you don't lose any time. And you feel together like you did something. And then you probably lose on the second day as well. But you continue. You have 5 days. This is a game that, well, frankly, I have rarely lost this game. But it doesn't really matter. The journey of it is immensely fun as you sit there and you divvy up who's going to remember what. Who's going to try to remember which tile so that you can efficiently get to the end. I love the teamwork, the collaborations that Leo the Lion gives. I love the sense of everyone working together. And despite it being a memory game, which I would not think would work, it really does. From there we have Grim Masquerade. Grim Masquerade by Druid City Games is one that, this one I've only played, actually I think my sons have played it. I think my older son has played it, my daughter's played it, my wife's played it. This is one of my daughter's favorite games. She wants to do a review on it. At some point you can expect that to happen on this channel. But she already did a review, by the way. We'll get to that at the end of this video. But in Grim Masquerade has this aspect of, it is I guess what I would consider is, it's kind of like a social deduction game, but not with the typical sense. It has an element of different players will be different characters in this game, trying to figure out who they are in terms of, are you Sleeping Beauty? Are you the Big Bad Wolf or whatnot? And every round, across three rounds, you're going to try to figure out who that person is, and you'll get points, roses or whatnot, in terms of deducing who it is, or in terms of being the last person standing at this masquerade ball where everyone is masked. The game comes with different ability cards that will be very every single round, so each of those three rounds will have slightly different abilities that affect the play. And it's fun, it's enjoyable. It's not a game that I would probably have in my collection except for the fact that my daughter likes it. I mean, this is not one I would play at game night or whatnot, but in terms of games that my daughter wants to pull out that are certainly not unfun for me to play, Grim Masquerade definitely fits that slot. And like I said, this is one of her favorite games. I'll keep trying. Yeah, that would be my Alexa because the internet is down. So, well, it is what it is. In any case, the Grim Masquerade, this is one of my daughter's favorite games to play, to pull out, to show her friends. She really enjoys this game. Next up from there, let's see, let's go with Horrified. Horrified is another one that this one only my wife, myself, and my daughter have played. My boys have not yet, although they really should. Horrified is a game that it's a pandemic-light experience. It's basically the monsters of, you know, well, the classic monsters, Frankenstein, Invisible Man, all that kind of stuff. And in the game, you're going to be trying to collect various sets of items to defeat the monsters. And the game has different monsters, and you're going to set up with different monsters. So perhaps this game, we're fighting against the Invisible Man and the Swamp, the thing from the swamp, whatever it is, the Swamp Beast, I don't remember its name. But in any case, perhaps you're fighting those monsters, and they have different ways of beating them, different ways of fighting and defeating those monsters. And you have to collect these items that will slowly show up on the board every single round as the monsters move around the board, potentially trying to damage you and hurt you. As the fear rises, which happens every time you die or every time villagers die, you're going to potentially be losing the game. And the question is, can you gather enough resources and can you accomplish the different things in the game before, well, before you lose. One of the fun things about this game is how the monsters affect the game every single time. You could play with 2, 3, 4. You can keep escalating the difficulty by adding another monster. So a 2-monster game will be, well, significantly less difficult than a 3 or 4-monster game. I've never won this game at 4 monsters yet. I've won it at 3, I've won it at 2, or we've won it. And so it is an enjoyable experience that shifts every single time you add a monster, because the monsters not just add difficulty, but they change the way the game is played. Every monster affects the game slightly differently. Every monster works slightly differently. Every time you draw a card, different monsters will activate in different ways and do different things. I appreciate the variability that this game offers. I appreciate the experience it gives. And I also appreciate the fact that it is incredibly easy to teach and to get to the table. Next up from there, let's go with, I'm trying to figure out which ones to save for last. Let's go with Trogdor next. Trogdor is an adorable game. I love, love, love Trogdor. This is a game that my daughter also wants to do a review on, so expect that at some point. But Trogdor the Burninator. Trogdor the Burninator, if you don't know, this is goes way back. I found it on YouTube, but it's from even before then. And Trogdor is a character who likes to go around burninating things. And in this game, this cooperative game, you and the other players are playing as Trogdor, trying to run around the village, burninating the countryside, burninating the peasants, burninating everything you can. And meanwhile, as a cooperative game, inherently the game is fighting back. So every single round, the game is going to try to fight back. It's going to try to push back and unburninate things. And unburninating things is kind of sad, because you want to burninate everything. You are Trogdor. You just want everything burninated. And that is the goal in this game, to, well, burninate everything. But meanwhile, the peasants are trying to stop things from being burninated. The knights are trying to unburninate the cottages. Things are trying to stop you from winning. Archers are shooting you, trying to trying to ensure that Trogdor takes damage and eventually loses. This game is absolutely adorable. It is one of my children's. My whole family plays this one together. It is one of their favorite games, and it is so thoroughly enjoyable for me as well. The production quality is through the roof. I have, I believe, the deluxe edition of this. There's multiple, even further deluxified editions if you wanted to pay like $200, $300 for a Trogdor board game. But the game is amazingly fun to play. It is amazingly... just, it's fun to burninate stuff, and it's fun to burninate stuff together. You draw an action card, you eat a peasant, you walk to a cottage tile, you burninate the tile, and it just, and then you hide in the mountains so the knights and the archers can't hit you. It is adorable. The theme is so much fun. The gameplay is so much fun. Oh, this is, I should have saved this for last. I'm that enthused about it. Next up from there, we have Can't Stop. And I tried to specifically save for the last ones on this list, the ones that we do all play together as opposed to select children. And so Can't Stop is one. Let's put this in the front over here. Can't Stop is a game. This is one of the oldest games in my collection, along with Acquire. And Can't Stop is, this goes back to like Griffin Games. Sid Saxon, I think, did a copy of this way back. This is a push your luck game, and it's one of the granddaddy of, I want to say it's the granddaddy of push your luck games, or at least it's one of the more notable ones. Every single game, and you can play this on Board Game Arena, by the way, if you want to try this online and just see if it's a game for you, check it out on Board Game Arena. It's a lot of fun. That's free, by the way. But in any case, in Can't Stop, every single turn, you're going to roll four dice, and then you're going to combine those four dice into two pairs and advance along a track. And you have three tracks you can advance on every single turn. And so you started off, you roll some dice, you're advancing on the 6 and the 8 and the 7. Great. And you roll again, and you can get a 6 and a 1. So you compare those up, and you can move along the 7. Great. And then you roll again, and you keep going. And then you roll again, and you keep going. And then at a certain point, you can choose at all points. You can choose whether to stop rolling or continue rolling, because the problem is, what happens if you roll, let's say, 1, 2, 2, 2? Well, now the highest combination you get from two dice is 4, and the problem is you're not advancing on the 4 tracks, so you reset all your progress. Basically, every single round, you can advance on up to 3 tracks, and if you ever roll dice and get a combination, or you do not get a combination that results in one of the 3 tracks you're currently on, you lose all your progress. Versus if you stop and you say, you know what, I'm good, then you save your progress on that board. And the first person to advance to the top of 3 tracks wins the game. It is immensely fun as you egg on other players and you say, no, just roll one more time, because, you know, you're sitting there with your, well, I guess, with your 6-year-old son who has managed to get all the way up to the track or close to the track. And you're like, just go one more time. Just roll it again. Just see, maybe you'll get it, because really you want them to fail. And to be clear, I don't do that with my 6-year-old. I do that with my friends, and they do it with each other. And it's adorable and fun. I mean, I don't know why I'm saying it's adorable to egg on failure, but it does work. It does not embody a toxic culture. Rather, it embodies this fun of just do this, and then when you fail, you all laugh together, and when you succeed, you groan, but you're also happy at the same time for them. It is a game that both works with math, both works with push your luck. It works with a whole lot of different things that I think are great for kids to experience, and ultimately you're advancing up the track and rolling dice, and that can be fun for children. Lastly on the list is Jamaica. Jamaica is a pirate family game that I frequently debate getting rid of this one, and yet I keep it because when we play it, it is fun. It does not hit the table frequently. It's one of the harder ones to get to the table because, well, frankly, it's a longer game. And this is a game that it is good for game. That is on the lighter side, to be clear. I think it works better as a family weight game or as a gateway game. But it's one that is on the longer side for my family, and it's why we don't get to the table as frequently as I would like. But in Jamaica, you are playing as pirates. Each player is one pirate trying to go around the board. And there's a few ways to get points in this game. First of all, the first person to finish will get the most points. They'll get like 15 points, something like that. I can't remember exactly. And then additionally, the closer every person got to the end when the game ends, the more points they will get. Or potentially, if they're too far back, the points they will lose. But there are other things you can do in this game. You can get treasure along the way as you stop off on the board along various parts. You can potentially dig up various artifacts that will either be treasure or in-game abilities, and those treasure things will be worth points in the game. Additionally, all the coins you have stored on your boat, and you have limited storage, you have 5 cargo slots on the boat, and you have to store up both food, which is essential for the travel, cannons, which are essential for, well, fighting each other, and then coins, which are essential to win the game, because every coin is going to be worth an additional point, and you can walk into the end having 25 coins and suddenly win, even though you didn't actually win the race itself. Now, along the way, you're going to, every time you land on a spot with another pirate, you're going to have a little battle, and that's where those cannons are useful. You're going to roll dice and try to figure out who won and who steals cargo from the other person's ship. And the gameplay mechanism in this game is that every turn you're going to roll 2 dice, and then you'll pick one of 2 cards from your hand that will show, okay, well, if the 1 is here and the 6 is here, perhaps I want to take 1 treasure and then move 6 forward. You're going to have to line up your cards to match the dice to potentially either get food, to move forward, to move backwards, to get treasure. So there's different things you can do to try to accelerate or figure out what you need to do to win the game. Are you trying to rush forward? Are you going to land in different spots? Are you avoiding certain spots? Do you want battle? Do you not want battle? This is a game where you basically are a pirate. And the pieces are adorable. The coins are fun to hold. The little pirate ships are fun. It really, the art and style of this game is immensely appealing. It is a game that we do not get to the table often because of the length of it compared to, you know, our family games and whatnot. But when we do, it is immensely enjoyable. And if you notice, that is 10 games, but I do want to throw in an 11th, and I'll explain why it's not a 10th, which is Creature Comforts is probably game number 11 on the list. And the reason this is not actually on the list is because it's not currently available. This is a prototype copy that we have just played. I'd show you the back, but there is no back. This is a prototype game that we just did just play. This is by Kids Table Board Gaming. This is a game that I have a review coming. They have a Kickstarter coming soon. So again, I didn't want to include in one of these games, you know, again, it's not actually available, but this is likely being added to the list of the types of games I play with my wife and my kids. This is a worker placement game. Again, watch my full review for it, but it's a worker placement game very much in the style of the world building of Root or of Everdale, with little woodland creatures and adorable little build your stuff, and you build little rocking chairs and bookshelves and do different things to get points. But it's ultimately worker placement with variable stuff happening throughout the game in terms of building up a tableau slowly but surely, collecting things. It takes place over 8 rounds, and it's a lot of fun. It is slightly longer, but slightly is relative, coming in at around 45 minutes to an hour for a game. But it is a lot of fun, it is adorable, and it does perfectly cross, I would say similar to maybe perhaps Jamaica or maybe Horrified in terms of game weight being slightly above some other games in terms of the mechanics brought to the table and the level of strategy involved, and yet simple and accessible enough that I think it is a great family weight game. And that would be the list over here. We have Jamaica, Horror, we have Jamaica, Trogdor, Grim Masquerade, Baron Park, Codenames Duet, Cobra Paw, Project L, Leo the Lion, Horrified, Can't Stop, and Creature Comforts as my bonus game number 11. I hope you enjoyed this list. I hope you found this video helpful in some way. This is the top 10. Again, it's a bit of an incidental list because this isn't necessarily my top 10 family games, but I would say it has a large overlap with my top 10 family games. There are a few that did not make the cut, like Indigo I talked about earlier, because just incidentally, they have not been a game that I played together with my wife and my kids. I either played one or the other. And that basically is the list. I'm Alex Radcliffe from Board Game Co. I hope you enjoyed this video, and until next time, have a good one.